Welcome to another episode of Pound for Pound Boxing Report, episode 158. I'm your host, Michael. Joining me this week, Gail Fuckerthal from Communities Digital News, Daniel Carpio from The Inscriber, Scorsese, YTBC fame. Somebody needs to, could everybody please mute? I'm hearing some echo in the background. All right, thank you. For those who are listening to live, those who are new to Pound for Pound Box Report, excuse me, Pound for Pound Box Report is a live YouTube show as well as a podcast and blog discussing all things boxing, modern wisdom, boxing. It's good, we'll talk about it. When it's bad, we will talk about it. Bottom line is, if it concerns boxing, we will talk about it. If you want to find all the information regarding Pound for Pound Box Report, one main place you want to go to, that's the blog page. P4P Boxing Report, .wordpress.com is the link. Check the right of the blog page. You'll find links to find our pages on Facebook, YouTube, G+, Tumblr, as well as where to listen to us on SoundCloud, iTunes, Stitcher Radio, Player FM, and as well as Google Play Music. Let's get the show started. Recapping what went down this past weekend. Want to start not this past weekend, but Friday night, the day after our last show. Robert Trouble Lee started defending his IBF lightweight title for the first time in his hometown of Toledo, Ohio, fighting Luis Cruz. Easton won by decision, put Cruz down three times, I believe, in the last half of the bout, including once in the final, once in the 11th round, I believe once in the 12th round as well. Overall, a solid win. Cruz didn't offer much resistance, but I look at it and I go to you, Scorsese, since you was not on last week. Easter on one hand showed that he's a really talented fighter, but at the same time, and then you can unmute your mic, Scorsese. I think I fixed the echo problem so everybody can unmute their mics. Scorsese, he showed that he's a talented fighter, Easter. But at the same time, you can see some flaws in his game, mainly in watching that he tends to smother his punches. Yeah. There was a lot of conversation on Twitter about the fact that they thought, and many people thought, that Easter should have knocked him out sooner. And the main point was, it was because of the fact he smothered his punches. He had Luke Cruz in trouble. But he got too close. He didn't use his arms enough to get distance to land cleaner shots. He instead went in there and kind of took the power away from his punches when he got close, tried to finish him. Your thoughts?
Yeah, I don't know if it's a regression, but if you looked at the fight where he knocked out the former 130-pound champion, that his name won't come to me right now, got knocked out by Bartholomew, and they reversed the decision. Dang, can't think of his name. Mendez, Ahenis Mendez. He didn't do that when he knocked him out along the ropes. He threw the 1-2, and when that 1-2 landed, it was over. We didn't get to see what was going to happen next. But the thing is, he throws that 1-2, and when it doesn't get you out of there, you're absolutely right. He starts going in with his shoulder and elbows, and that's smart stuff if you're not as long as him. That's pretty good stuff. You could use your shoulders and elbows to open up spots. It's illegal, but you know, the referee not calling it, it's not fighting. You can use your feet as well. But for him, you got limbs. You got willow trees. You don't need that. You just sit back there, keep that distance and punch. Box Nation ripped him. And I agree. I wasn't like, that was the only thing that was problematic to me in some of his style of fighting that he would choose. He would look sort of confused to how about cracking the egg. Or not confused, just like kind of playing with the food. I don't know. It's maybe one out of two. But the only thing to me was the inability to keep the distance. I like the fact that, you know, he has a high guard defense that he can catch with those elbows. I like that. He pulls all that back. He's probably the best conditioned athlete out the Broner camp, things like that. I respect that. Looked like the hardest worker out of them. I like a tall fighter keeping the guy on the end of his punches, walking him down as well. I like that from him. It wasn't a great performance, but without his intangibles, well, not the intangible, the height, the solid height that he has, I still want to see him versus those other champions. And soon, like not next fight soon, I still think he's a test for anybody because of that right there. You know, smothering your punches, that just could mean somebody lasts 12 rounds. That mean they can absolutely beat you. He still is an inside fighter. He's. I want to say this point. If he goes to 147, 154, that stuff's going to help him. It's going to help him. If he gets other guys his same height, that's going to help him. Because other guys, 5'11", they can't get in there and muscle and turn. So, you know, he's doing something that's going to help him in the future. But as of now, you should have kept that distance and weld away. You know, that's simple as that.
I'll go to you, Gail, and then Daniel. Piggyback on what Scorsese was saying, his breakdown of Easter's win over Cruz. I think we're kind of jumping the gun a little bit before talking about 147 for 154. I think he has a ways to go, but still. The potential is there for Trouble Easter in spite of the flaws that he showed Friday night.
Absolutely, potential. When you say it's a solid win, that's not an extreme compliment, but we got the job done. Scorsese's assessment was excellent. The one thing I would add that concerned me is, yes, he had his opponent down several times with plenty of time in the round remaining, and he could not close the show. He could not do it. And on a couple of occasions, it looked like he gave it a try and decided, not happening, backed off. Other times, he just seemed to step off the gas entirely, seemed to figure, well, that notched me another point, good enough. I like to see a little more killer instinct, especially with a younger rising prospect type of fighter. So we'll have to see where he goes from here. He got the win. He did what he needed to do. At times it was entertaining. So that's progress.
How are your thoughts, Daniel?
I missed the fight live. I caught little bits and pieces of it. But I don't see as much regression. He may just be just fighting down to the level of his competition because Cruz was never a threat. So he may have just been taking the night off easy, which I can give him due. It's his first offense. It's in his hometown. I get it. Like I said. But sooner or later, then Broner Bandcamp has to put him up against because the logical fight is Mikey Garcia. If Mikey Garcia doesn't decide to go through with Jorge Linares or Anthony Corrales. We have to look at that answer. That has to be one of the next fights because otherwise you might start seeing to do things like what we've seen Felix Verdejo do. Like we've seen him do well and then his promoter stalled on the level of competition and we're seeing him regress because of it. I don't want that to happen to Robert Easter.
Dan, you point out something I want to jump on that dovetails with my comment about Easter not closing the show. If you're going to close the show anywhere, it should be in your hometown. You should feel motivated to really put on a show, and he didn't. And that is a concern. And funny you should bring up Verdejo. That is exactly the name that was floating around in my head thinking, you know, he's had some of the same issues. His are certainly more concerning. You know, with Easter may have been the concern about the defense, the nervousness. He's still a little inexperienced against his raw skill level, but we need to watch that.
You mentioned future, Daniel. Let's just open it up for everybody here. I don't think he's ready for the likes of Linares, Mikey Garcia. I think he can compete with them right now, But I want to see him in a position where he has a real, real legit chance of beating them. And given what I saw last week, I just don't see that yet. He has the physical attributes to do so, but not quite. Hold off on that. So, given that, let's look at the rest of the lightweight landscape. I believe, Daniel, I heard you mention Crawler. There's Flanagan out there. There are other lightweights. You mentioned Verdejo. Where would you he has, I believe, a number one a fight against Shapokov, who I believe is his number one contender. In what direction would you like to see Trouble Lisa go? And I'll just open it up for anybody who wants to respond.
Well, it better not be Garcia right now. That's for
sure. I mean, that's why I preface this by saying, like, outside of a Garcia or Benares, who I just don't think, I don't think Easter is ready for those two. Not yet.
I look at a dude that's 6 foot, and I look at every opponent that's a champion, and I say, when has that champion had to cut that kind of distance if he decides to just keep you on the end of his punches? And then when he opens up and start fighting you on the inside, it's no easy fight for anybody. And that right hand is trouble. It is 100% trouble. He can beat anybody any given night. He could be beat any given night. And that's the beauty of fighting. If I'm not going to tell a fight, if look, you're 22, you're 21, okay, you know, you're green, rest it out, see what's going to happen. I think this guy 26, 27 years old. Get it on. You bigger than that. If I'm 6 foot and I'm looking at 5'5 Mikey Garcia, I'm looking at previously knocked out, cuts very easy Jorge Linares, and I'm towering over them, I want him. And he wants them. He's saying it. I want them right now. He's been said it. So yeah. I agree.
Yeah, but yeah, Garcia in particular is really heady, smart guy. Well, and he may want him, but he don't necessarily want that power from Garcia. Yeah. You saw what he did to Dejan.
Yeah, that's the thing, Skirt. That's the thing. Like, he can say, I want Mikey, I can tower over him, I can want Linares, I can tower over him. But those two could literally box circles around him right now.
And Linares is about Garcia has skill and particularly power. And Linares, yeah, he has a weak chin and whatnot, but he's a boxing fool.
Yeah, like that hand speed is insane. Like I said, Robert Easter has not seen that hand speed yet.
It's hard to box circles around 6 foot. I literally think he stops Linares, Mikey Garcia. I think it could go either way. Five times. I think guys win two. I think we see like career opponent type things going on where they could just be beating each other and people like, yo, let's do it again. That division, I don't see no number one in that division until they do it. With me looking at that size, if I'm 5'5 and I see athleticism, I see a guy that can punch that cleanly, I don't feel like I'm super confident. I have to show myself I can do that.
Did you say earlier about how Easter opens up? He can get hit, and about how he smothers himself.
I don't see the get hit part. I see a good defense. Of course, he gets hit. Everybody does, but the good defense is what he keeps them hands very high. Though, you know, he has a very good defense walking you down. You know, we got Shafikov next, so that's a good fight. You know, we're gonna see Shafikov ain't gonna let him breathe. He's fought Comey already. When you fought a Comey, and he fights as hard as he did, you fought everybody. That's how I look at it. You are experienced. Comey is no joke.
Comey's no joke, and they said, but there's an argument that can be made that Comey won that fight. It was that close. So there's the whole thing. You take that with Comey, who makes fights with a lot of heart, and you put him with a Mikey Garcia, who, if anything, shows how to patiently break down somebody. And you have somebody in Linares that, like I said, he's probably never seen hand speed like that before. If I'm Easter's management, yeah, I would take care of my mandatory. Take care of Shakakov right now.
IBF ordered it.
Yeah. Or if you're going to be really crazy, go to Petrov and screw up any plans that Anthony Crawler or Hortonaris have. But there's not much. Like I said, because to me right now,
Petrov is taken by Flanagan.
No. Petrov right now is the mandatory for he's the mandatory for the winner of Kralla Linares too.
I thought Flanagan and Petrov actually had a stare down
Yeah, Petrov and Flanagan are actually going to fight in April.
They announced they fight.
Yeah, but if he wins, think about it. If he wins, which he very well might, we are talking about Terry Flanagan here. And then, yeah, shout out to Gus who joined us. Like I said, we are talking about Terry Flanagan here, so you might make a unification fight. It's the probably the easiest unification fight for you to make.
One more point you think about Mikey Garcia, and people keep mentioning Lomachenko. They mentioned Linares. I say to that this. If you wanted Linares Lomachenko, I know he hasn't like signed an official deal, but he's basically a Heyman fighter at this point from what we're seeing. If you wanted those fights, you would have stayed on that side of the pond because you knew it was smarter to do that. You on the pond, you on the side where Easter is, and that just to me, that means that's the fight to make. And to me, whoever wins it, that's dope. That is no excuses. You're active. Go for it. Like I just will feel like Mikey has the uphill battle because this guy's a that don't make no sense. That hype, man. Just that's crazy.
Let's get Gus into the discussion. I'll mute your mic, Gus. First of all, Gus, I want to say my condolences to you. I know you suffered a loss in your family. You reached out to me on Skype, so I want to send my condolences to you on the loss of your uncle. We're talking Trouble Easter and his win over Luis Ortiz. Briefly assess that his performance, and we're also talking about where should Easter go. Following this win, I was saying he might not be ready for Garcia and Linares, despite his height and his physical attributes, because I see some flaws which were shown in his win over Luis Cruz, but there are other options for him at 135. So just kind of put all that together.
You know, Mike, sort of defensively, I was very observant as to whether he was making the same sort of mistakes in the previous fight, and there was one fundamental flaw in which I've seen historically what he was doing. He was shoulder rolling, but he was turning his head to the right, and hence he was not even paying attention to the punches that were forthcoming, specifically in the Comey fight. Hence it was the roundhouse rights that was coming sort of anti-clockwise when he was looking away, which was catching him. So in this fight, I was very keen to see whether he would try and negate that deficiency. And what I saw early on was very encouraging, because what he was doing was that he was more using his footwork. Soon as Cruz was coming forward, he was taking two steps back. So he wasn't employing that shoulder roll, which was good, because that was a fundamental mistake he was making. But offensively, Mike, he's just fighting too much in spurts. You know, I'm very critical that he really doesn't put his punches together. You know, the combination punching is not really in his lexicon. He's still firing one punch at a time. When he gets a little bit confident, when he knows he's hurt his opponent, then he can, you know, come forward with a little bit less less skepticism from the point of his opponent hurting him, so he can just keep coming forward. But defensively, he's still vulnerable to straight punches, and that was the problem in the Comey fight as well. But Comey wasn't working his body, he was working his head, so that victory could have been a lot easier. So there's still issues both offensively and defensively, but it looks like he is paying attention to some of his flaws, so he's still a work in progress at the moment. I would be very, very skeptical about putting him into a unification. I think he'll lose against pretty much all of the other champions.
It's from Twitter, while watching about Easter smothering himself, particularly on the attack. That's one of the main reasons where I thought against, particularly a Garcia, with his power, if he tries to come forward and opens up, that could cause him to get countered by the precision of Garcia. Your thoughts, Gus?
Easter, what he did show in his previous fight is that he can fight on the front foot. We saw that against Mendes as well, and he can counter punch, because in the Comey fight, in the first sort of few rounds, it was Comey's pressure forward that was pinning him up against the ropes, but he was starting to have success when he began to counter punch. The Garcia conundrum for me will be that Garcia is just a master of setting traps and ambush. So although he'll be able to come forward, but sometimes he's negating his height. But that's nothing. There's nothing wrong with that. You know, Santa Cruz does that. But the only reason between him and Santa Cruz is that Santa Cruz's chin is buried in between his pecs.
Yeah.
And his right hand is almost super glued to his chin. So there's no gaps in his defense. It's not porous. But with Easter, it is porous. Now he's relying on taking steps backwards. So maybe he's utilizing more lateral movement in his defense. So I certainly do give him a chance. You know, I mean, he does hit hard and he counter punches, but Garcia is just a little bit too clever. And we know he hits tremendously hard, you know. Any man who breaks Marcus Maidana's ribs in sparring, giving away sort of 20, 25 pounds, you know the power's for real there.
Indeed. Let's move on and talk about the undercard. I'm not going to try to pronounce the guy who beat Rashid Warren, but he beat Rashid Warren in what was really supposed to be a showcase bout. I was always skeptical of Warren. The guy he fought twice, his name escapes me right now. Right. The guy that previously won, he fought twice. The guy that won fought to eventually win the belt. Payano, I think.
Yeah.
I was watching those fights. I was like, okay, he got the wins, but I don't see anything special about him. Same thing in this fight. My problem with Warren is, and I was discussing this on another show, is that some guys are physically fast hands, fast feet, but that doesn't necessarily mean that they're skilled and they can really box. And I'm going to you on this one, Gail. That's what I saw in this bout. Warren, to me, he's not a real boxer. He's not a real craftsman. He's not a real technician. And he doesn't always fight smart. When he fought in the middle of the ring, he was pretty successful. The problem is he lounged around the ropes too often in this bout. And even in individual shots that he was landing here and there of his opponent was consistently throwing punches and kind of stole the fight from Warren. Warren made this fight much harder, much more difficult than it needed to be.
He did. The opponent, Zana Zakyanov.
Or double Z, as Gus called him. I'm going to stick to that.
Well, a lot of people have called him ZZ, and I think that's going to stick, especially if he sticks around longer, given this victory. You know, it looked like the fight would end early. I mean, Warren came blazing out at the opening bell. He got Zakyanov knocked down twice in the first round.
Yes.
He popped up both times. But it looked like he might do what we really should have seen Robert Easter do. But ZZ, he pulled it together. He lasted the rest of the 11 rounds. He outworked Warren 150% and took his belt. Yep. The problem I see with Warren is he has bad habits from being in the amateurs a long time. He's never made a good, strong transition to the professional ranks in a professional style. That's why you see him hanging on the ropes. You know, he still somewhere must have in his mind, you know, that idea about scoring points. Nobody gives a shit in professional boxing whether you're scoring points from punches. You have got to perform. You've got to show a lot more varied skills. And heck, you've got to, if your guy is coming after you to put you on the ground, you better do it first. And for him to have scored those knockdowns early, you know, he had a 10-7 round, and then lose with that kind of start, inexcusable. It really was inexcusable. And the truth is, I thought home cooking might protect him. And you know, good for those judges. They did not let that happen. There was one that gave the fight to Warren, 115-111. With a 10-7 round, I don't know how in the hell that happened. The other two judges had their sanity intact, and they scored it 115-111 and 116-110 for Zakianov. Thank goodness. So hopefully he will, you know, take advantage of this. He will capitalize on this great opportunity. And as pleased as I was to see ZZ get the victory, I was even more pleased for his trainer and promoter, who's Ricky Hatton. Ricky Hatton was elated when he heard "and the new," and that's a nice thing to see. He deserves it. Ricky's had some really rough stretches, and good for him. That was a nice little win for him too.
And speaking of Ricky Hatton, Gus, open your mic, please, to kind of make sure that that ZZ would get the win. He was working the room, as anybody knows who follows Hatton, any hardcore insiders know, there's a connection between him and the WBA. So yeah, he was working the room. All that being said, I think the decision was just. Warren let ZZ take the fight to him. He just didn't fight a smart fight.
Yeah, you know, Micah, Rashid Warren, to me, he's almost like a 122-pound version of Kareem Mayfield. And it's disappointing his transition, because when I saw him Chicago World Championship, Mike, you know, where he was a gold medalist, and it was, you know, one of the better world championships, where even Frankie Gavin and people like to shit on him won the gold medal there, and that guy Viktor Selikov, who beat Lomachenko, won the world. So it was a brilliant world championship, and Warren looked actually very, very good. But making a transition from 3 rounds to 12 rounds with his questionable gas tank, because there were elements in the first round where he looked magnificent, you know, just great combination punching, where a double Z was, obviously he was just trying to cut the ring. Warren was just moving on his back, half circling, then trying to shift the other way, just trying to change up his footwork a little bit. Caught him with a great right hook, one uppercut as well, which hurt him on the ropes. Then came in with a good combination punching as well, which put him down. So he looked fantastic in the first round. Double Z looked quite badly hurt, and I was a little bit worried where he would even come out for the second round. But you know, he came out. I think he was hurt again in the second. But then he really started to mount his offense in the third. Just gave his objective. He had one objective, and it was to collapse the pocket.
Right.
Just give Rashid no room whatsoever, to the extent where his back is almost back, leaning back towards the rope, so he's getting no leverage on his punches at all. Knowing that your opponent has put you down, that's probably the best way, just to pin him down, try and smother his work, and just unload with your clubbing punches. You know, it was almost crude like clubbing punches, but he had a very good overhand right, and he would fire it. He would vary how he would fire it as well. Very clever in the way he did it, and he was just consistently landing. You know, he was relentless. You know, you've got to give a guy tremendous credit coming back from a 10-7, effectively 3-0. In Ohio as well, and a very hostile crowd, Mike. I don't know what you gauge, but I felt the crowd were almost vociferous almost in their hate for him, especially when the judges were correlating, you know, the scorecards whatsoever. I didn't like what I was seeing, but you know, tremendous victory for him. You know, he was just, he kept coming, he kept getting stronger and stronger. He wasn't even slowing down at all. Whereas conversely, Rashid Warren, up from about the 7th and the 8th, was just literally gone. He had no plan B. He had no power to fault him off the ropes. Adrian must be disappointing, but I think we spoke about it after the Piona fight, where we felt he was very fortunate, I think, in the second fight to win, that he's... you know, his defense, you know, would be very, very short-lived.
Scorsese and Daniel, your thoughts on this one?
I saw a funny fight. I saw one guy that trained like a madman under Ricky Hatton. And once again, the Broner camp coming in a fight looking to throw 18 punches around, and it don't work. It does not work when you can't control pace, when you don't have the feet to do it. I don't know what he should have done different. I don't think he can beat this guy at all unless he did what he did in the first round. Hit him and hurt him. Can't beat him at all. I didn't see him winning rounds later. I didn't score the fight, but I was watching the stream, not super tactical. You can't see everything. But I saw what I need to see. One man putting on his work hat, and another man putting on, I'm getting my ass kicked hat. And he got his ass kicked. As simple as that. The title went the way it needs to go. I enjoy watching the little man go to work, putting him up against those ropes, throwing all those punches from different angles. You would hold one arm and Rashid would look to block the body. And he'd just club him with that right hand. Like, man, he's kicking your ass, man. I tell you this, if they wouldn't have gave him decision, Rashid Warren body and his overall health would have told him the next day that dude, he's the champion, because he beat him down. Ricky had, like you said, I'm happy to see him get a belt. Once again, the Michael Stafford school of boxing would not be the school that my son, like Floyd Mayweather said about Virgil Hunter, would be in my corner. I don't agree with Virgil, but with Stafford, he wouldn't be in my corner. I don't know what these dudes are learning. Rashid has flashes of brilliance. Some of his body shots, they look magnificent. His speed looks magnificent. But you know what flashes belong? In night photography, not boxing. So that's how I see this. ZZ, I don't think I'm missing the next fight. He wasn't playing. They need to take notes. Ricky, how did you train him? Ricky, how does he throw? How many punches did he throw? How many punches did this man? Man, come on, man. Rashid, no, but that and the new rightfully. Simple as that.
I tell you, Scorsese, as long as ZZ doesn't go out on the night at the pub with Ricky Hatton, man, because that guy will be like drinking 36 pints of Guinness.
your thoughts, Daniel, before I ask a question of the future of both guys.
Well, like I said, this was one of the fights I missed, but I did catch some highlights. And yeah, like I said, I got to give props to Ricky Hatton. He trained a hell of a workhorse. And you can tell that, I guess now we do have to call him ZZ, because yeah, I'm like you, Mike, I don't like butchering names. And ZZ looks to be well on his way of graduating into the Ricky Hatton school of pressure fighting. And it was a good win. I am really surprised, like Gil mentioned, that we didn't see any home cooking this time. And ultimately, a good win for Hatton. Like I said, he's been hit a lot, unfortunately, but from his fighters over the last year. Now, granted, a lot of it is not his fault, but good to see him be on the top, either as a trainer or as a promoter.
Let's talk future here for both guys. I look at this, I look at the way the fight went, and only see one direction for either guy, rematch. As I said, for Warren, I wasn't that impressed with him coming into this bout. And while ZZ, he fought like a house on fire, I look at him vis-a-vis the rest of the landscape at 118, I don't know. I don't see him beating. I don't see him beating Yamanaka. If McDonald decides to stay around for a couple more fights at 118, well, McDonald's getting ready to move up to 122. Haskins, maybe. Topalis, Gus, I'm here to inform you. I know you like Topalis, but yeah. They're pointing Tete his way, and if he fights Tete, he's losing. So, again, I just only see one direction in the aftermath of this fight, just setting up a rematch between these two, between ZZ and Rashid Warren. Your thoughts, guys? And this is for anybody who wants to comment.
I'm not sure I need to see a rematch, but I wouldn't be surprised if it happens because of the lack of very obvious opportunities for either one. And, you know, maybe it's a way to, you know, make a more solid case for the winner, assuming it's easy again moving forward. Yeah. If the money's there and the audience is there, eh.
Yeah, let ZZ take his ass over there to the UK because of Ricky Hatton influence and make Rashid Warren ass go to the UK and take another whooping because he can't beat him. He can't. You just saw it.
Well, you're absolutely right. And so why do we need to see that? We know what's going to happen. I mean, we know it. You're right.
That was a mandatory.
Should be, and that's all it would do is give, you know, the local fans a show and, you know, perhaps give them an opportunity to get to know ZZ a little more, and maybe the British fans will adopt him, you know, much as the Southern Californian Mexican-American fans have adopted his countryman Golovkin.
Hadn't said bring on the rematch in the article. And what was the other point I was looking at? I lost it. It's mandatory. This was a mandatory fight, so I really doubt he had a clause to say, oh, you get a rematch if you want it. So he might be shit out of luck.
Well, I think that's true. I'm sure he didn't anticipate he was going to need one.
Well, whoops. I mean, he could fight Piano. ZZ, where do you see him going?
Certainly for his next fight. They're talking about a summer fight at the Manchester MEN Arena, Mike. 118, there's enough domestic fighters as well. Somehow I think Rashid Warren won't, even if a rematch is offered, I don't think he'll travel. I don't think he'll take that rematch. Deep down he knows he took a systematic beating. He's not going to get lucky again, you know, and have a free round advantage. So I expect him to go a different direction, maybe even move up to 122.
How about your fight moving up to, eventually moving up to challenger?
Sorry?
How about your fight moving up to 118 to challenge him eventually? Because he can do it.
Could be, but I think the 115 just looks too lucrative, Mike. I think your fight is obviously looking at those potential pound-for-pound fighters, Japan and sort of Gonzalez and Estrada, and I think he wants to stay. Remember, your fight is the incredible shrinking man who shrunk his body down to 115, so I don't think he wants to undo all that hard work, but it'd be interesting. I think the division for me, that Mexican Mike, I think Luis Neri is the future of that division. He's hot on the tails of Yamanaka now, and I think he'll get past him. Possibly Neri and Tete and Tapias, I think, are the three for me.
Let's move on. Yeah, let's move on. You had a lot of good fights this year, but what went down on the same night as Easter and Cruz on Showbox between Baranchik and Ramos? Wow. That's all I got to say is wow. I mean, Baranchik, he won by decision. Pretty wide score, on the judges' scorecards. But at the same time, that didn't take away from what kind of fight this was. Leading candidate for fight of the year so far in 2017. I just sat back and watched and enjoyed. I didn't even tweet about it. I just enjoyed it for what it was, and I'm just going to open it up for everybody here who saw the fight. It just go, because yeah.
Is anybody got a link for that fight? I haven't seen it.
Gus, you need to see this fight.
Yeah, you missed one, Gus. You really did.
Yeah.
While y'all talking, I will look up a link for it, and if I find one, I'll share it with you. But anybody who wants to talk about this, just go, because wow.
Yeah, I tweeted ECW.
pretty much.
That shit was ridiculous.
I mean, old 90s ECW. Yeah.
Oh, man.
I'm not going to say, I don't mind anybody who wants a fight of the year, because it's not like a eliminator that's going to get them a title and a title, but I understand, like, the action wise, if you
that's
just.
That's what I'm talking about. This from a sheer action standpoint.
Yeah, I can't remember the trade of knockdowns and who got knocked. All I remember is it never stopped. I think the guy was Mexican. He took a beating. This Baranchek guy is a damn machine. May not be world class, but I want to see him fight world class fighters, because your title can't go in just one night. And when somebody's a machine and they just had a will to say, I'll take this ass whooping, but I'm going to give a little more than I take. He could defend once or twice. He 140.
Scorsese, keep on. But check your Skype, Gus. I just found it.
140 on Showtime. You got Diaz, Rances. You got Broner. You got Granados. You got Imam, who needs to prove he can handle some pressure. Shit, after this fight, I got to looking at who is this dude. And I want to see more. That was ridiculous.
I mean, in round three though.
Let's not even. Let's go talk about round by round, because first of all, Miami, Oklahoma has become a little hotbed for boxing. J3 Promotions is doing a hell of a job in that little town. Like, they're building him. They're building Tommy Morrison's kid there. They're doing a really great job, but this fight, Jesus. Like, okay, first of all, Ramos is coming from the Robert Garcia gym. So you already know he's going to come to bang. And then you have this kid who's nicknamed the Beast, and he comes into the ring and it's locked in a cage.
Yeah.
That's right. And, I forgot about that.
Yeah.
And that's just some damn good entertainment, you know, right from the start.
Yep, and they started early. Like, Ramos got round three. Ramos got hit and got knocked down. It was a flash knockdown. You can tell he wasn't really that hurt. He got up quickly. He took a little bit of a whooping and then landed a nice left hook. And it almost looked like Rancic was gonna go down for the count just because of the way he fell. And then that was even topped by round six. I don't think there was a moment where it stopped around six. Yes, Gus.
Is this that dude that is in the cage and he sort of breaks through the chains and he's.
Yep.
Yep.
The
yep.
one.
Yep.
Yeah. Yep.
I've seen that and before. I like that.
Yeah, and he's with a new trainer too, but he didn't look like it. But you got to give up to Ramos. That round six is right now the leading candidate for round of the year. Like, you have to do something obscene to top that right now. But, like,
it was boxing rated X.
Pretty much. Pretty much. Like, Ramos didn't want to stop. Like you could see the heart that the kid had. And it's not only him. Almost that entire card was great. Like I said, in the first fight, they had an eliminator. I think this kid named Fernandez from Mexico, and then a guy from Michigan named Garza. And those two went at it. Now, granted, yeah, Fernandez won third round knockout, but that kid Garza fought the way you're supposed to fight a taller fighter. Take away his range. That was just a hell of a night. And this was just the nice little cherry on top. Not even cherry on top. This is pretty much a tres leches cake mixed with flan. That's how good this fight was. And you can tell those two did. You can tell those two literally went through hell. Like when they looked at each other at the end of the fight, they like, I did not expect this. They looked at each other like, I did not expect this. But yeah, that the combinations, like Baranchik, I love the way when he Ramos took away the headshots, he immediately started throwing like 8 or 9 punches straight to the body while he had Ramos on the ropes. And then Ramos just decided to outbox him with the jab to get out of it.
Yeah, he's sick with those body shots. That's why I noticed that too. He just refused to go upstairs. Like, he was happy in the living room. He didn't want to go to the bedroom, just downstairs all night. This dude was, I'm telling you, I want to see, I don't know his record. I don't know how many fights he's in. I don't know where he's ranked. Don't care. World-class opponent, me hell. That's what I want to see. Because that dude is hell. He not a human. That doing shit like that, you ain't a, no. I refuse to call you a human.
Are folks sick enough to put these two in the ring with each other again?
Yes, yes, they are. Yes.
We were just talking about Warren and ZZ in a rematch, which very few of us would really, you know, care to see. It would strictly be for the British fan base. This one, who wouldn't want to see this again?
That guy ain't going back in there with that monster.
Well, and I'll tell you, the only danger is the expectations are so high that I'm not sure they could possibly meet them. You know, perhaps you just let that experience pass into boxing memory, because every time you looked up, you know, the tide was changing in a different direction. You know, you're convinced it's almost over. In fact, I had somebody with me watching where we were kind of having a chat on the side, and I'd have to stop and say, well, hold on a second. Well, let's let this finish. Well, then it didn't. And we'd go back, and I'd have half an eye, you know, trying to be polite and, you know, pay attention, which was becoming more and more difficult, because if I was getting so fun to watch, and I'd have to stop him in mid-sentence and say, hang on a second, because something else had happened. So it was a great fight. Anybody listening who has not seen it, do yourself a favor.
I got a homework assignment for you, Gus. When the show is over, your assignment is just to watch this fight and enjoy it.
I want to know what's, like, I'm so caught up in the fight, I can't even remember the Latin guy's name.
Ramos.
Ramos. Okay, Ramos, I agree with what you said. The fight took those ebb and flows. It was times where his punching power was just flaily arm, absolutely nothing. And then next thing you know, boom, I'm like, And he's throwing the shot. I said, Lord. Yeah, Gus, you're probably watching it already. Do yourself a favor and fast forward it and get to the goods, man. It's crazy.
just start at round 3.
I concur with that.
Yeah, this is how good round 3 was. Baranchik was losing pretty badly in that round. Lands that punch, gets the knockdown, and Ramos just counters it almost in the nick of time. Like, technically, during the 8 count, the bell should have counted already. I think right around it was 5, but they gave him a little bit more time. But Jesus, man. And I still didn't top round 6.
Yeah. Look, first of all, Baranchik needs a rest after this kind of war. But going forward, I'm not going to. Crawford is two levels above everybody in this division. So don't put him in the picture of all the challengers, champions, whoever. Who would you like to see this tiger in the ring with?
Molina, Broner.
Yes.
Diaz, Rancis, Relic, shit, bring it on. I love them. I want to see more.
No, him and Molina would actually be a really, really good test, because Molina, like, say what you want about him, like I said, it's like not being world class. He's right now like a level above Gatekeeper in that division. Mm-hmm. So he can easily test you to see, okay, are you really the goods or are you Mickey Bay?
Mm-hmm. I'll go to you on this one, Gus. You familiar with Tito Acosta? If you are, your thoughts on his win last Saturday in Puerto Rico, setting up presumably a fight with him between him and Tanaka at 108.
I didn't, Mike. I've been so far back on fights with other aspects you know about. So the Saturday card from the US was pretty much the only card I've seen.
Understood. I don't know if you, outside of that, have you seen any of Acosta, Tito Acosta?
Yeah.
What are your thoughts for those who are unfamiliar with him?
He's decent, but I don't think he's in the class of, certainly at 118, and 118 is now becoming a real...
Well, 108, actually. Yeah, 108.
108, sorry. Light flyweight, it's becoming an amazingly deep division now. Plus, we think about jurisdiction as well. You know, we've got three of the champions being in Japan as well, one other in Mexico. Because the other Japanese fighters, it looks like Tanaka is probably going to be in the unification fight now. They're talking about Yagashi, so Acosta. There's talk that he might even get the fight with Taguchi. That was what I was hearing. So, and they spoke about actually having that fight before he fought the Venezuelan fighter. So
yeah, I was saying Tanaka, because it's been reported that this fight earned him a shot against Tanaka, and I think they have 90 days to make the bout or something to that effect. So that's why I was mentioning him, Tanaka specifically.
Yeah, no, that's correct. This is that's the next step, is that Tanaka is the mandatory WBO mandatory. So they've got their 90 days, and otherwise that fight goes to purse bid. So.
Not unless Tanaka gets so unification,
right?
Which is what he's talking about at the moment. So that'll take precedence.
Yeah, I need to reach out to my sources, particularly Asian Boxing on Twitter. He'll give me the rundown, because you're right, Gus. There is talk of a bout between Tanaka and Yagashi. I think Taguchi is the more appealing fight, but I can understand why they're going after Yagashi. Talk about some news here. I'm going right back to you, Gus, because you've been kind of out of the queue. The big news of the week broke a couple of days ago. A lot of questions about Kell Brook. What is he going to do next? When word broke that they're pushing back negotiations with Errol Spence for a week, a lot of speculation was that they did that because they're trying to low-key get a deal to fight Miguel Cotto. But on Tuesday, Kell Brook, Monday or Tuesday this week, Kell Brook tweeted that I run for no one. I'm paraphrasing. I run for no one. The fight that you want to see, myself and Errol Spence, is going to happen. I applaud Brook here. They're going to fight in May, either the 20th or 27th in Sheffield. UK's perspective, Gus. Thoughts of Brook going through with this fight. People surprised. People applaud Brook. What's the vibe over there?
You know, Mike, you know, the announcement or the provisional announcement of this fight, I think it's invoked a lot of bittersweet feelings from folks here in the UK. Because from the standpoint of two athletic, you know, supremely gifted fighters, it's a mouth-watering matchup, and it was something that we were hoping to see last year. But sadly, the events that have precipitated the build-up have marred, to a certain extent, the excitement, because folks over here are not stupid, and I think a lot of people agree almost in the entirety with what Errol Spence has recently stipulated, in that Kell Brook has tried to exhaust almost every option as opposed to fighting him. And you can't disagree with that at all, because the evidence is incontrovertible. And we know that Kell Brook and both Eddie Hearn, they like to talk and to continuously yap their mouths about mega fights. And obviously Eddie will be a little bit more diplomatic and try and hedge his position, because as a promoter, you can't stipulate one thing until it's concrete. But Kell's plan A, plan B, B, C, D have all gone out of the window. And the Miguel Cotto fight was the one that really has incensed me, because you're talking about a fight that wouldn't have been at 147. It would have been at a catchweight. It would have been at either in New York or in possibly in the UK. And that says to me that Kell Brook, at this stage of his career, is not interested in legacy or winning championships. He's more interested in prestige and money, pure and simple. And that is a very dangerous mindset to have when you combine that with a fighter who has to now cut, 40 pounds, and combine that with a fighter who is coming back from a broken eye socket. It doesn't matter how mentally tough you are, that injury will be at the back of your mind. And when you're facing a power puncher, you are going to be worried, and there are going to be aspects of his body language in the ring where he's going to be maybe a little bit cautious in terms of taking head punishment, etc. So it is very disappointing. And so when the odds even opened up and Kell was, a 2-1 sort of favorite, that obviously doesn't surprise me, because Errol Spence is not known in the UK, although he has fought in London and I saw him in London. But he's not fought or not been on the UK television or satellite television. So there is that degree of unknown from some of the casual fans, but the hardcore certainly know what Errol Spence is about, and that he's extremely well touted. And he's obviously been endorsed by Floyd Mayweather, hence why it's shot his reputation up to the extent where people are crying that Kell now must fight against his mandatory, where previously he was given a lot of a condemnation for fighting mandatories who people perceive to be very poor opponents. So that whole perception is very, very interesting in boxing. But the fact that Errol Spence, I think, knocked out Floyd Mayweather in sparring, and he's been on his card as, people have, and that ESPN have made him, their top prospect for the last 2 years. So, that reputation is certainly there, and we know he can fight this kid. So there are mixed feelings, but a lot of people are actually putting money on Errol Spence to actually knock him out. And you know what, given the way the odds have opened up, I think that's a very, very smart bet for me as well. I've already put money down on that.
Oh, I'm sorry, I was on mute. I'm sorry. But to your earlier point, Gus, prior to the bout with Triple G, I felt that Brook Spence was the best fighter in the division. Matter of fact, I was so far to say I thought it was the best bout. It was the bout between the two top welterweights in the world. Coming off of that Triple G loss, I still think it is. But, and I'll go to you, Gil, I'm not as confident about it. The key for me, how is Brook physically and mentally following that fight with Triple G? How will he react when Spence hit him? Conversely, how will Spence react when someone, if Brook can make the weight fairly comfortably, putting that in quotes, how will Spence react when facing someone just as strong physically and big as he is? And how will he deal with fighting in that environment in Sheffield, which should be on fire the night of the fight? That all comes into my mind. I'm making Spence the favorite, but if Brooke is there 100%, he can certainly beat him. Bottom line for me is, I'm just glad this fight is finally being made, even if it is a year or so late, because there was skepticism about whether this fight would happen at all. And it shows me that not all the welterweights out there are ducking Errol Spence. At least one guy who's willing to step up to fight him.
Yeah, all props to Brooke for doing that. You know, I'm surprised he's made the decision to fight at 147, given that he looked fairly good at 154 and seemed to thrive after the Golovkin fight. It was the indication he was going to perhaps stay there, but apparently not. What's going to make the difference in this fight is how Brooke processes his various experiences. Interesting, you should talk about how is Spence going to react getting punched by a really strong puncher? Well, Brooke has an advantage there. He's faced a really strong puncher. And while he didn't win, he survived. He did survive. The fight was stopped. Let's remember that. So Brooke knows what it's like to take those sort of shots. That's an advantage to him if he sees it that way. He also knows what it's like to be in hostile territory. Let's think back to his surprise win over Sean Porter. If I'm training Brooke, the first thing I do is make him sit down and watch his performance in that hostile environment at the StubHub Center. And I was there, and trust me, it was hostile. I make him watch that. I make him watch that and see what he did right. And in spite of the odds, he won. To make him wash away the experience of the Golovkin fight and treat it like it was an anomaly. But he does have the experience. He needs to be able to process that to his advantage and use it. And he'll end up being a fairly formidable opponent for Spence. I do, though, want to keep an eye on him in those weeks leading up to the fight about the weight issue and see how it's affecting him. You know, once he's had a fight at 154, you know, 147 isn't going to be all that easy for him. So I'm a little concerned about that part, which, yeah, makes me see this really as, depending on the crowd and physical condition and his mindset, could be a 50-50 fight, which would be the absolute best possible scenario.
Scorsese, Daniel, your thoughts that on the fact that this fight is finally being made too late?
Like Gus said, yeah, I agree with Gus. It did lose luster for me. And some of it's Spence. You're contending a prospect and you're fighting two times a year. I know that probably has something to do with Al Haymon going through the lawsuits and things like that. A lot of his guys were inactive, but yeah, it did lose luster. Neither one of these guys are greatly promoting themselves. I will say this, Cale Brook went on a suicide mission, then he exhausted exhausted all options. I agree that too. He went on that suicide mission, and now he kind of blew up Spence in that mission as well. You know, he took some victims with him, but when he got into afterlife, they said, you know what, your hell is 12 rounds with this man, and it ain't gonna go 12 rounds. He's getting knocked out. I watched the Porter fight numerous times. I'm watching it right now. Matter of fact, I'm gonna tell you how many minutes long it is. It's 44 minutes and 55 seconds, and it's only 6 rounds. And the man is probably, it's only 6 rounds of video. He's probably held this man 80 times. I'm not sure. The UK referees, they are very strict on holding normally. This, when I watch these fights, I used to think to myself, certain guys couldn't fight in the UK. They don't even let you clinch once when it's a mutual clinch. They're warning people. I want to see that because I want to see, is Cale Brook a complete fighter or what was that, just the game plan? Just say, you know what? I've never seen him fight on the inside, but Maybe that was the game plan that night. Just say, you know what, I'm going to hold this guy. Couldn't hold Golovkin. Don't think you'd be able to hold Spence as much. I'm starting really not to like Kell Brook at all, like very little. And I want to see him knocked out. And I think the skills and the attributes of this fight says he will be knocked out. He does not have some great defense. He's nothing but a sharpshooter, in my opinion. He's a sharpshooter. Earl Spence is not Sean Porter. Sean Porter drops those hands, bends at the waist and the knees. He does it pretty good. But at this level, you need some hands up. Earl Spence is textbook. The hands are always there. He's getting that outside foot advantage. Well, he will get that this fight because it's going to be southpaw versus orthodox fighter. So he will be looking for that. And that's going to take counters away from Kell Brook. I think he's getting beat up and beat up badly. If you go to the Sean Porter fight and you ask who was more badly hurt the next day, Kell Brook took a beating. He took a beating. He won the fight. I agree. But he took a beating. He couldn't control the pace. He couldn't do anything to stop Porter from banging his body. He gives up the body so much. He's standing straight up a lot. I think he's – a lot of people say he's got great legs. I think he's kind of stiff. That's just my opinion. At points where he's setting up a shot, yeah, he looks nice. But I just don't see Earl Spence giving him a second, any space. I think a knockout shot, that's all Kell Brook can do to win this fight.
Your thoughts, Daniel?
First, I want to jump on the Gil bandwagon, giving respect to Kell Brook on this, because I'll say it as a man who's currently celebrating his birthday, at least in our time zone here. Mr. EJ Boxing Live did come in last week and pretty much say that Kell Brook was going to bitch out of this fight. Lo and behold, he did it. Now, you can say because there were no other options available. But then again, if the other option, you did have an option. You can just say, I'd rather go to 154 and then just vacate the belt. But no, he's choosing to fight a kid, Earl Spence, who's proven to be the truth when it comes to a good textbook boxer that is a mean bastard. And it's going to be a fun fight. Like I said, this is going to be Errol Spence's time to ultimately shine. He has to see how he handles somebody that is as big as Brook, but then Brook has to handle somebody not only that can do the pressure Sean Porter, Scorsese mentioned, but somebody that has a mean streak tied to it. Because Errol Spence has a little bit of a mean streak in him.
And that body work. And Brook's fourth inside fighting is not his strong suit. Let's just put it that way.
Yeah, that's the whole thing. And that comes a lot to the effect of Kell Brook, unfortunately, is known for putting on a lot of weight in between fights and then pretty much spending a good amount of his camp just cutting that weight. That eventually catches up to you. It just takes the right opponent to point that out. Now I said Triple G wasn't going to do that in the sense where he could beat somebody, but in the sense of when it comes to Kell Brook right now, if you look at the division right now, he's by default the best fighter in that division. That can make a unification fight, because in that sense, I do have to exclude Pacquiao from this. But it's a real good test for Errol Spence, and good on him, because either way, his next fight should have been a title shot. Either way, whether it was going to go WBA route or WBC route, he earned that title shot, and I'm glad he's finally getting it.
Speaking of Daniel's point about Brook blowing up in weight, which is very true, have we seen any images or any photos of Brook, your weight, Gus, to see how he's looking physically? Does he look really out of shape, i.e. Billy Joe Saunders, in a lead up to his fight with Akhavov? Excuse my pronouncing his name wrong, but have we seen any images of how Brook is looking physically, Gus?
Yeah. Mike, you know, Kell is making Billy Joe Saunders look anorexic.
Oh, damn.
Yeah. He's looking about a good I'd say about 185, maybe 190.
That's not good. That's not good.
It's not good. And I'll tell you, Mike, the only reason why Kell Brook is taking this fight is that when a fighter is unable to secure the unification fights, and he's unable to fight his domestic rivals. And I know they reached out to two people at 154 as well, and he's unable to secure against fringe contenders at 154 as well. Now, if you cannot get these fights without being a champion, how the hell are you going to secure almost any fight when you don't have a belt? He will just fall into the realms of obscurity. You know, that is the only reason why he's taking this fight, because he knows the belt is his only tool. And it's, and let's face it, it's not a significant tool, because he's not able to get any of the fights that he was trying to prognosticate. So he's in a very bad position.
Let's move on to some news that broke today. Take this from two angles. First off, Jermon Charlo, IBF 154-pound champion, earlier today decided to vacate that belt. Tony Harrison, Jared Hurd are going to fight each other on the Deontay Wilder undercard. That bout will now be for the IBF junior middleweight title. I'll go to you on this one first, Gail, and you can follow up Scorsese. First of all, thoughts about Harrison and Hurd now being a title fight. Also, how do you think Jermon Charlo, off of his very good stoppage over J. Rock Williams, how do you think he will fare at 160? Can he land a bout with Triple G? Can he land a bout with Canelo? Your thoughts?
It's a great move for everybody involved. I like it a lot. Let's go to the Harrison Hurd fight. You know, it gives them a little extra juice, something to fight for. You know, Hurd was my prospect of the year in a very close call over Erickson Lubin. So let's see if his promise can be fulfilled. But he'll have plenty to handle with Harrison. And, you know, raise those stakes. That's exciting for everybody. So that's great news. I also do think Charlo made a smart move going up to middleweight. You know, Golovkin has really, with the exception of Canelo, whatever the hell weight class he thinks he's in, or, you know, who knows. You know, Golovkin has kind of exhausted a lot of his key opposition. I mean, you have a few guys floating around out there, but, you know, who the heck knows what's going to happen with Eubanks or Saunders or, you know, some of those guys. So why not have Charlo, you know, step into what is a bit of a void, really, with talent at 160. You know, those players have all been cleared out. He can work his way up. He can test himself against, you know, those guys that have already been cleared at 160, depending on what happens with Daniel Jacobs. Yeah, you see some potential there. You know, he's certainly the underdog in the Golovkin fight. So let's say Jacobs loses. Well, let's put those guys together, see what happens. You've got, if he can make weight, Toriano Johnson. I mean, he really blew it not making weight here a few weeks ago at Fantasy Springs. He would have been considered a live wire. You know, who knows what's going on with him. Or maybe Charlo gets those fights over in the UK that aren't happening. There's just a lot of good variables for Charlo, and why not step into that breach and, you know, see what kind of fights he can make for himself. If I'm a matchmaker, I find him very attractive coming off a really showcase win for him.
Go to you, Scorsese. Look, Harrison Hurd, you was really excited about the fight, even added incentive now that it's a title fight. But Charlo, there's some fighters out there. Look, for me, if Billy Joe Saunders is about that, come to the U.S. and fight this guy. Why not Charlo fight the winner of Stevens and Lemieux? So while he may not get Canelo or Triple G right away, Scorsese, there are opportunities out there for Jermon Charlo at 160, and there are fights for him.
I think Scorsese dipped.
Okay, I'm sorry. I don't have my screen up. I had it on another thing, so I'll take that to you, Daniel, and then Gus.
I'll be as diplomatic as possible when it comes to Charlo, but I want to get into this Herb fight first. Good for the IBF to decide this quickly and not go through this all eliminator stuff. Make this fight. These two kids have deserved it. And now you've made the Wilder fight even more of an event. Like I said, we mentioned Scorsese literally said this was the fight he was literally driving to Alabama to go for. So that's going to make him very excited. It's a really nice turn of events. Good on the IBF. As far as Charlo, the first fight I see him is probably going to be him and Sergio Mora.
Why?
Because.
Just why?
Seriously?
Oh, man. Yeah. I don't expect much out of him when it comes to that aspect. Like, okay. First of all, Billy Ho's going to try to weasel his way out of any potential fight that seems a somewhat of a threat. Like, I guess his camp is the one that's throwing, like, those little rumor mills that he's willing to take a Triple G fight in Kazakhstan.
But the problem is, coming off of his last bout, Billy Joe Saunders, he needs something.
He needs something, yeah. But he's going to try to get away. Frank Warren's going to try to protect his belt. And that's out. We don't know the mental state of the Eubanks family from time to time. So we don't even know if that fight can be made.
It's not the mental stability of the Eubanks. I seriously wonder whether Chris Jr. can get down to 160. That's my concern.
I personally think he can. It's just the fact that the guy running his career is his dad. So that's one area into it. But they're going to try to ease him into it. Unless they really try to push for it and say, I want to be the number one contender for the IBF title. That means fighting Toriano Johnson right now at the moment, who still hasn't been taken away from his number one contendership, even though he came in 4 pounds overweight. You have to deal with that.
Didn't even try to make weight.
Yeah. Well, once you come into 4 pounds overweight, you kind of knew. So yes. the winner of Lemieux Stevens. You better cheer as hell that that's Curtis Stevens then. Because if Lemieux wins, there's no way that fight's happening. And other than that, like unless he's the one that can convince Peter Quinlan to cool down back to middleweight, or at least just show up in a boxing ring, there's not much out there within the PBC universe unless he really, really tries to push to get a mandatory for Triple G.
He can fight Danny Jacobs.
Well, I don't know if Danny Jacobs is going to be up for a fight after what Triple G is going to do to him. So,
well, no, but that's very makeable, and that should Jacobs lose, he's going to need to find a dance partner that's worthwhile, and that'd be a good one. But I agree, Charlo needs a fight at middleweight first before he tackles Jacobs. I mean, win or lose, Jacobs is still, for him, a significant opponent. So, I mean, you're right. I think the ideal would be for him to fight somebody like Stevens or Toriano Johnson. If Johnson's going to stay at middleweight, that is. And, I don't know that we've got anybody young willing to take him on at this point, just to test themselves, but there may be somebody, hovering in the top 30 or 40 willing to take a shot at him. And, you make that fight within the PBC and get him out there and get a few rounds at 160 under his belt.
Let's get Gus into this discussion. The news today of Jamal Charlo giving up the belt, Harrison and Hurd fighting for that vacant belt now. Thoughts on Harrison and Hurd now being a title shot, and also the future of Jamal Charlo vis-a-vis middleweight. What do you see?
Yeah, and I'll talk about the Charlo news, Mike. That first I've heard of it, so thank you for breaking that to me. Not a surprise, but if we strategically sort of break it down now, a unification and a big money fight at 154 is seriously minimized by the fact that his brother holds one of the other belts, and Errez Landy Lara And we know the three of them are, you know, a very close-knit unit, and his brother. So clearly he's not going to fight either of those. So that's what's he going to do. Is he going to wait for Demetrius Andrade to come back from Germany, and, you know, when he picks up a regular WBA belt? No, I can't see that. And, you know, there's nothing significant about acquiring that belt, which is eventually going to be phased out anyway once the WBA get their head out of their asses and they consolidate it.
They haven't so far, what makes you think they're going to do it now?
I've been talking about this for 2 years with these guys. 39 belts they've got now. It used to be 43. So in 2 years, they've just cut it down by four. Well done, WBA. So, all right, 160. Now, it's a bold move because it suggests that he is lining up either Gennady Golovkin or Saul Alvarez. I think he's realized that Alvarez is not going to fight anymore at 154. If he's fighting a catchweight 164.5, then he's not going to come back down to 154. So it's either him, Golovkin, or Danny Jacobs, if hopefully Danny Jacobs becomes the champion. So he's potentially looking at that because one guy is holding three belts. So there's not a great deal more of maneuvering he can do there. What's he going to do? Just go there and fight fringe contenders when he can fight them here at 154 anyway. So one of the other belts being in the UK, but that's... You know, that's just been a bit of a crazy situation. So I don't think he's going to bother with any of the UK fights. I think he'll be given open access to fight on any network. So if it is fighting on HBO to fight any of the other two, then I think that is what he'll do. So I'm hoping that that's his bold strategy, and it suggests it will be because he hasn't got any other options. So credit to him, you know. Let's hope his power can go up there, and let's hope he can, you know, cause some ripples, because that's the poorest middleweight division since the history of boxing, in my opinion.
Which is why, as an aside, when people try to throw up Gennady Golovkin as an all-time middleweight great, I'm like, how, given the weak division? I'm not saying Golovkin is not good, he's very good. But how can you say that when this current middleweight crop isn't even half as good as the middleweight crop of the early to mid-90s?
Since the Marcus of Queensbury rules come in, Mike, I can go back 1894, list all of the champions at middleweight. He wouldn't even, well, I don't think he would favor well against any of those personally. I think even Dick Tiger and Ruben Carter beat his ass, man.
And also, second question, since you've been kind of away dealing with your own family situation, thoughts on Harrison and her bout, even prior to the news that it's now going to be a title fight?
Mike, when the fight got announced, I was like, you know, fantastic. You know, it's a magnificent fight. You know, I like both fighters. I like Jarrod Hurd particularly, but Tony Harrison is enormously skillful with, you know, really quick hands. So it's a great showdown. I knew Jarrod Hurd was ready. When I've seen him before, he's got everything. He can fight on the inside and outside, and he likes to entertain the crowd as well. So I'm glad they've stepped it up. It's a bonus that it's certainly for the IBF. You know, we're in an era where, you know, people can pretty much fight for a belt after fighting a gimme or a fringe title fight. So you can't be overcritical. It's happening pretty much left, right, and center, almost across every weight division. So, you know, that is the norm when you have too many belts. You know, you're going to get a title shot pretty easily, but it's a good fight. Stylistically, Harrison might have the hand speed, but I worry a little bit better about Harrison. I think Jarrod's Hurd's uppercut is going to be the major weapon in this fight. because Harrison, when he's coming in on the inside, you notice his head, he doesn't shift it all the way. He almost leans it forward, and I think it's almost tailor-made for what Harrod did to Molina in the first round when he slipped that jab and hit him with the uppercut. I think on the if Harrison chooses to fight like that and he comes in on the inside, then I certainly would favor Hurd. But Hurd can certainly fight at long distance as well. But Harrison ain't no mug. You know, he's got beautiful hooks and he circles very well, both clockwise and anti-clockwise. Sets very, very good traps. So it's a... I might have to hedge my bets on that one, but...
I wouldn't bet on that fight if I were you guys.
It's a difficult one, but I'm leaning towards Jared Hurd on that one.
Indeed.
When is that fight, Mike?
It's on the undercard, actually a week from Saturday, on the undercard of Wilder's return to the ring.
Okay. Brilliant. Fantastic.
Any other news you guys have before we start closing the show down, previewing what's happening this weekend?
Well, let's see. Okay, let me check here.
Other than nobody bidding a purse on Shannon Briggs' bout.
and the fact that we care so little about the Lamont Peterson fight, we haven't even mentioned it.
Well, I'll mention that in a little bit, but there's a couple of things that have been happening. I'll throw this one first, because in light of Scorsese, remember, he's the one that first thought that this was a ploy. We all pretty much thought that Manny Pacquiao's fight with Jeff Horn was signed, sealed, delivered, right?
Not really.
Good. You have a panel full of skeptics here until we see the tickets being sold.
Yep, that's good. Because when Aram is trying to say fight in Australia, Michael Conz is trying to say, no, Manny Pacquiao's next fight is going to be in the United Arab Emirates. And then he puts up a list of opponents. He put in Jeff Horn. He put in Kell Brook, which we know now is not going to happen. He put in Amir Khan. And I forgot who else he put in. But it was a guy he didn't face before either. And they're running the poll right now, and Amir Khan apparently has enough fans where he was currently winning.
Yeah, well, he was also winning in the poll for Mayweather's final opponent. So give me a break.
Yeah, there's that, but it shows a certain disconnect that Bob Arum has with his golden horse, apparently, because... Oh, no, yeah, I just remembered, yeah. The fourth guy was Crawford.
Well, right.
Yeah, so there's...
That's going to happen.
So there's an apparent disconnect between Bob Arum and the Pacquiao team, probably involving money, because...
Oh, Pacquiao, you see? Yeah. But yeah. Arum would not be fighting in those venues if it wasn't about money. He wants to establish a foothold, you know, in these areas with lots of money and lots of resources who don't have a boxing culture. He wants to be the promoter of Asia and apparently the Middle East too.
Yeah, you're spot on, Gail. Bob Arum actually owes Manny Pacquiao money. This is what the problem is. Manny Pacquiao actually signed a waiver. First of all, if you actually read his contract... And people have got all these pre-misconceptions. He has a guaranteed return of a £20 million purse. That's a guarantee. It's not a negotiating or bargaining tool. And because in his last fight, they had to put it on top-ranked pay-per-view, Manny Pacquiao actually signed a waiver to say that, okay, he'll accept a lower concession, but on the provision in his next fight, Bob Arum actually pays him $20 million. So hence... The site fee in Dubai, from what I'm hearing, is by two businessmen who have put up $15 million each. So that is why Bob Arum, he's got no choice to take it on there because he owes Pacquiao money.
Yeah. It's like Roc Nation's issue with Miguel Cotto.
Yeah.
I mean, they got to stage something, whether we, the fans, want to see it or not. because they got to pay him anyway.
Well, there's the whole thing with Miguel Cotto. That's why the fight and having that fight with Kirkland in Texas didn't make sense. This doesn't make sense other than the fact money for Pacquiao, and then the opponent's issues coming up makes sense. Like, okay, yeah, Crawford's not gonna go to he's not gonna go to Dubai or Abu Dhabi to fight Pacquiao. He's gonna demand either Vegas or Omaha. We know Kell Brook's tied up. Well, Jeff Horn, like I said, it's the fight that most people thought that was gonna happen. And Amir Khan, I really, really doubt that Amir Khan, because given what happens and how Dubai and Abu Dhabi run, and considering the crap he had to go through just within his own family in public, I really thought that Amir Khan wants to have questions saying in a press conference promoting the fight with Pacquiao, how do you feel about your fellow Pakistani being slave labor here?
I tell you what, though, for all those who thought Amir Khan was finished, God damn, did he show some amazing hand speed on Skype.
Yep. Yeah.
I tell you what, yep. Daniel.
A Muslim fighter in an Arab nation, I mean, it does make sense from the promotional standpoint. If they can get the timing right between his religious obligations and Pacquiao's political obligations, and that might be very difficult.
Yeah. Well, let's see here. Pacquiao right now is currently in the Philippines arguing against transgender rights, which is no surprise. So, yeah, he might want to get away. He might want to get away.
Which is not going to hurt him in an Arab nation. You know, it's not going to be quite as big an issue as if he came back here to a barrage of criticism.
I don't want to say not really, but from the times that I've been in the Middle East, that's actually a pretty vibrant subculture. In there. The only thing that's stopping it right now is the fact that Saudi Arabia is just big.
You know, yeah, let's be real. Of course, is there the subculture everywhere? Of course there is. Of course there is. There always has been. Is it socially sanctioned, acceptable, politically sanctioned, acceptable? No, far from it. And so Pacquiao's statements in certain parts of the world are not as big an issue as they would be here, existence of the community and their feelings aside.
Yeah. But the worst part about this, again, everybody, the worst part about this, unfortunately, it does raise the hairs on the back of my neck, because now the ghost of me, Pac 2, is getting resurrected.
Oh, stop.
Because if you're pulling this crap now, like Gus mentioned, they owe him money. They owe him a whole crap load of money. And unfortunately, Manny Pacquiao is the MC Hammer of the boxing world. So there's legitimately, unfortunately, only one fight that can make him a crap load of money that he would do, and that would probably satisfy his team. And that's what the fight that scares me the most. It's a rematch with Floyd.
Oh, stop.
No, I hope for the love of God that Floyd legitimately wants to be a promoter, that he wants to stay retired, that he wants to still mess around and just troll Conor McGregor whenever he wants to. But, oh, God, that's why reason this raised the hairs on my back and my neck, because I'm fine with Pacquiao facing Jeff Horn. Okay, go make your money in Australia. Like, you have a lot of Filipinos there. It's a young fighter, but when you pull this stunt, and now that Gus mentioned that how much money they actually do owe him, yeah, there's not a lot of options there that are going to give him that money. Even Bud, unfortunately, even fighting Bud here in Vegas won't guarantee him that money. And it's a fight where Pacquiao probably would not be favored in.
Yeah, he can't afford to fight Crawford. I mean, on many levels, because it isn't going to create the kind of payoff that happens in one fight. It means he'd need to take another, but he'd probably lose. So then he's damaged goods. you know, it's going to be interesting here. Floyd is going to have a fairly visible appearance in a couple of weeks. He's got a showbox card in Southern California and it happens to be taking place on his 40th birthday. So you can imagine Showtime's going to make a big, big deal and he'll be front and center. And I wouldn't be surprised if we get, if there's an announcement to be made of some kind, you better be watching Showbox on the 25th of February, 24th?
Yeah.
Checking that calendar, that would be the 24th. I advise all of you Floyd watchers to be watching Showbox that night.
One final thing before we move on and start previewing the fights. Going to you, Gus. The promotion for Joshua and Klitschko, how is it being received? I know it's been in England. It's had a stop in Germany today. It's had a stop in the U.S. as well, but particularly in Europe. The reception for the press conference, are people pumped up about it? What do you get from it?
Hard to say, Mike. You know, I mean, it's not been promoted on sort of major news channels. It's a lot of, we know Sky as a corporation, which is now obviously owned by Rupert Murdoch's Fox company almost outright, as they pretty much bought all of their shareholdings. So they have their own sort of in-house news channels as well. So hence the promotion tends to be specifically based on the sort of in-house Sky platforms. So there's very little coverage on say radio or any of the domestic channels, which can have up to sort of 18, 19, sort of at least 40% of the population watching it at a time. So from the standpoint of people who actually subscribe to satellite TV, there has been forums, and I've been having a few look at the forums today and having a look at the sort of betting odds to see if it kind of reflects the publicity which is being generated, because they are pretty much campaigning end to end. I'm hearing they're even talking about maybe even going down to South America, but I'm not sure how realistic it is there, because they're talking about opening new inventories, new markets. Sky are actually trying to open up markets over in Africa as well at the moment. So the conglomerate machine is in play now. So, but from another point, Mike, they've been trying to campaign with the mayor of London and transport police to try and open up Wembley stadiums to its full capacity. Previously, it was rejected from safety issues, so they put a cap on it. But I'm hearing now that the mayor is actually prepared to allow Wembley to host up to sort of 90,000, so to increase the original allocation by 10,000. So it is, from the standpoint in London, now receiving major attention, and but the betting odds are still very, very much in favor of Joshua. I'm still looking at Klitschko 8-2. I'm actually favoring Vladimir Klitschko quite strongly. I don't think he's taken any sustained beating, so I still think he's got the ability to beat him, and beat him by knockout as well. It's still in motion, Mike, but nothing significantly across the board. But I'll know a little bit more next week as I'm sort of back into the boxing fold this week now.
Okay, good. Thanks for the update. Let's move on and talk about what's happening this weekend. Mainly, Adrian Broner coming back to the ring to fight Adrian Granados, who beat, I think, Amir Amin not too long ago. In Ohio, I think the bout is in Cincinnati. I could be wrong. The big news, it's in Cincinnati on Showtime. Big news, of course, this bout was scheduled initially to be at 142. It's now being contested at 147. Had alarm bells ringing for a lot of folks on boxing social media about what kind of shape Broner is really in. I'll go to you on this one, Gail. This cause for concern for you. For me, this is just Broner being Broner. I mean, you saw his last fight. He weighed, what, 141. He bulked up to 170. Long issues getting down to weight for some reason. Lack of discipline, for us, I'm concerned. But I hear people are concerned about this. But for me, again, this is just Broner being Adrian Broner. So this is no surprise for me. Your thoughts on this and how could it impact the fight? The thing I will say is you can't have questions about conditioning issues going against an Adrian Granados in the style of, in the way he fights and his mentality that he brings into the ring.
Absolutely. I wouldn't be surprised if we see a repeat of the Maidana fight here, except in fewer rounds. Broner is one of those guys that just irritates the hell out of me. And y'all know who else is on my list in this regard. Broner's right there. Somebody with natural talent who, with just the tiniest application of discipline, could have some significant achievements at this point. Instead, he's let his antics outside the ring, his lack of discipline, his screwing around, really take a toll on his career. He had trouble making weight four divisions ago. Yeah, he was on Twitter bragging about having a junk food Jones and not being able to make 126. I mean, this is ridiculous. You know, you get to this point, you're now in your what, fourth, fifth, sixth division? I don't even know, because he so irritates me. I only pay attention to him when I absolutely have to. His behavior outside the ring is in many regards reprehensible. He's disrespectful to every group I can think of. And you know, and the bottom line is he's disrespectful to his damn self. And you know, these are people I don't really want in boxing. And it is a shame. He does have skills. He does have some tremendous talent. He's just simply squandered it a lot. And just take one look at his dad and that's what that guy's going to look like. You know, that day is unfortunately not that far away. So, you know, Scorsese, how's your supply of those whoop-ass hats? Because we need to buy one for Broner. You know,
I'm on that train. I'm
get
on
my
that
ass train. Whooped hat and put it on him, and the administer an ass whooping hat on Granados, and I will be a happy girl then on Saturday.
Your thoughts about the change in the weight for this fight, Scorsese?
Like you said, Broner being Broner, a press release come out, they ask the press about it, and you get nothing from them. They basically say, "Don't answer the question." That's what I heard. So just what I heard. But at the end of the day, I got to root for Granados because I got a favorite fight in that division. Even if he's even in that damn division anymore, 140. I don't know what the hell Broner doing. Daniel asked me on his show about 2-3 weeks back, is Broner a circus fighter since Canelo is? And I said no, because I said Granados coming off a nice win, and I think both men to be at their best at 142, so I'm not going to complain. I don't mind a catch weight if I look at the fight and say, well, no titles, cool. Both men at their best? Yeah, okay, fine with it. You know, but now he has made it a circus. He has turned this shit into something I'm going to watch. But I'm here hoping that Granados, man, like if you want to be a joke, you can be a losing joke. You're a mediocre winning joke right now. You want to talk about four world titles? You lost as soon as you won it. He was trying to fight Dante's Boxing Nation, what I saw. He was literally picking on the dude. And then they said, if you said another thing about Sean Porter, you're getting put out. Well, you need to be reminded of what happened with Sean Porter. And I don't even know if I agree with Gail anymore that the skills are there. I think everything's gone. The man, he falls in when he's punching. He just is sloppy. He can't fight, but what? 10 punches around.
That's because his legs can't handle the higher weight score, Stacey.
Well, yeah, his knees are buckling. Exactly. No, don't misunderstand me. He had skills at one time. He has squandered them. He's absolutely squandered them.
Okay, that's a fair assessment. Even at 140, in the last fight with the guy that's can't think of the name right now. He beat the guy up pretty good with clean shot, but he was taking break after break. He's on the ropes. I'm in shape. No, the hell you ain't, because you can't finish the guy without the referee stopping the fight when it probably didn't even have to be stopped. Because you couldn't put on the onslaught. You couldn't put on the onslaught.
You're talking about the Transformer.
Yeah.
Ashley
Alec Verde. Alec Verde. Khabib Alec Verde. So for Broner, I'm at the end of the road. No need in you being a mediocre winner. They're not going to feed him to the wolves. Why? Because he makes a little money. But I hope this wolf comes along and say, I don't need you to feed him. I'm going to eat his ass because I want to eat his ass. And I hope he then fights the people at 140 that Broner won't fight to get him opportunities. Real fighters there. If he don't want to be that, he can be an entertainer. And I watch Adrian Broner entertaining to me. Like I said, I fool with ignorance until it starts running for presidents. I will watch it. Okay? So if you want to be an entertainer, you go for it. But this boxing shit, you can leave it to the fighter.
I deal with ignorance until it starts running for
presidents. Oh, my God. That's why people listen to this show.
Gus, Daniel, your thoughts on the situation with Broner again. And the way,
you know, Mike, this whole situation is just fucked up beyond all comprehension. Now, 24 hours after they were announcing that we've got a new focused and motivated Broner, they announced that the weight is being knocked up by 5 pounds now. How the fuck you put on 5 pounds when you've got a spout of flu? From my understanding, when you have the flu, you actually lose weight.
Right.
Because you don't eat and your body's breaking your fat mountain to actually sustain you during your illness. So to me, it sounds like the only thing it could have been was that he was hungover. He's been back on these binges and he's been taking the piss left, right, and center. And let's look at this from Granados' point, Mike. He's getting a payday 3 or 4 times more than what he was previously getting. So is he really going to say no to a 5 pound weight increase and sort of turn down that payday? That's the position he's in. You know, so it's a fucking disgrace. And had the fight been at 142, I would have definitely have favored Granados, because this kid is damn talented, man. And he's been in with some good fighters, you know. Now, I'm really, really high on Frankie Gomez, and he was involved in a great fight with him. It was giving him a hell of a lot of trouble as well. And he changed his tactics. He normally has a shocking first sort of 3-4 rounds, but then he just transforms. And now he should be called a transformer, because he just transforms second half of the fight, and he just becomes like a relentless monster, just sort of, you know, just hunting you down and just you know, putting your punches together. And you know, just a tremendous, you know, heart and will and attritional fighter. And whereas conversely, I agree with Scorsese, Broner now he's become a flat-footed, wild-hooking, you know, lazy, never engages. When a fighter is unloading, he'll just cover up. He will not trade punches. Exactly what Gennady Golovkin does, man. He always covers up whenever somebody's firing back, if they're able to take his punches. And a bit like Gervonta Davis, Mike, his biggest problem is that he's stiff-legged. His right leg has to be planted for him to throw a punch. If his right leg is not forward, he will not throw any punches. So it's very easy to calibrate a strategy around beating him. But Granados is not—he's not a big 140 guy, so for him to be fighting at 147, you know, it's really taken away some of his advantages. So, I don't know whether Ray Brown is just going to eke out a real ugly, ugly victory, almost hugging him to death in that sense, almost clinching him. I'd love to see Granados knock his head off his shoulders.
He's going to look for a clean shots victory. He's going to look for, I landed 7 clean shots, that type of victory. Yeah, that's what it is. Yeah, it's horrible. Yeah. I said it. A Saturday night of Broner, just don't fucking cut it no more. It just don't. I'm sorry I interrupted, but this dude, I'm pissed, man.
before I go to Daniel, Jacob, who's a regular, Jacob from Jackpot Boxing, is a regular. Couldn't make him on the show tonight, but I want to give a shout out to him because he's checking us out on YouTube. He's checking out the live show, so I want to give a shout out to Jacob listening to us live.
Daniel there? Is Daniel there? He said he'd be right back. Yeah. Okay.
I want to give him that quick shout out, Jacob from Jackpot Boxing. Daniel, your thoughts on this situation with Waite and Broner once again?
Oh man. When I talked about it, Jordan Francis on Sunday, like I said, because they know the kid, he spars in the gym that Francis used to go to and spar herself. Yeah, they're kind of happy. They're a little bit happy that Broner decided to pull this off because maybe Granados is going to work a little bit harder now to really beat the living daylights out of Adrian Broner. Because one thing you beat a kid is motivation when he is already the underdog. He was the underdog in the Amir Mom fight, and he wound up beating the living daylights out of Amir Mom at the end. And now when you watch the Showtime promos, literally it's just Broner. Just Broner dancing, talking about I'm about boxing, and then like in the end, the last 10 seconds, takes on Adrian Granados. That's motivation for a kid right there. Yeah, so I do think honestly now that Granados is gonna beat the living daylights out of him. And he's probably gonna do it in the worst possible way. And it wouldn't happen to a better person than Adrian Broner, who's pretty much made a mockery out of the sport. And the only reason, unfortunately, that he is allowed to keep doing this crap is because he's one of Al Heyman's favorites. So he keeps getting chance after chance after chance after chance, even though he does almost absolutely nothing to earn it. And people need to know, like, some people do confuse Robert Stafford a little bit. I've met people that literally confuse Robert Stafford with being Adrian Broner's father. No, it's the guy that kind of looks like Fat Albert whenever he wears red. that brushes Adrian Broner's hair. That's his father. That's what he's gonna wind up as, unfortunately, because he can't control himself. There has been nobody that has seriously stepped up to him that A, told him the truth to his face about what he's doing, and B, that Broner respects.
Let's talk about the undercard. David Avanesian, who I believe last time out defeated Shane Mosley, finding Lamont Peterson come off of a 16-month layoff. I'm going to you on this one, Gus, first. For me, this bout is all in Peterson's hands and how he looks. Peterson can be kind of up and down. See, when I look at Peterson and the way he fought Garcia, particularly the second half of that bout, I think he wins and can win in a pretty comfortable fashion. However, Peterson doesn't always fight that way. He can be kind of sluggish, doesn't throw his hands enough. And that can cause him to get out-hustled, which I believe Avanesian has the capability of doing so. But Peterson, Lamont Peterson, to me, he's the faster fighter, the more skilled fighter. Even though he's kind of moving up in weight, I make him the favorite in this bout. Again, for me, this all depends on how much Lamont Peterson wants it and what style he really brings into the ring.
Yeah, I think you're exactly right, Mike. You know, Lamont, loved watching him fight over the years. You know, I clearly remember that Victor Ortiz fight, Mike, where I think he was like down two or three times very early. I can't even remember. Was it the first or the second round? But he got up and managed to secure a draw. But I felt, you know, he'd actually won the fight anyway. So in that fight, you know, he showed coming back from adversity. But then he had fights where against Danny Garcia, where I felt he won very easily, Mike. I had that fight 9-3. You know, early on he was choosing to be a little bit more elusive, fight laterally. But then when he actually stepped in on the inside, he was actually hurting Garcia.
He was backing Garcia up.
Yeah, absolutely. He was, stronger than him on the inside and heavier handed. He was physically moving him around, and you could see the damage on Garcia's face as well. But clearly the judges thought he was he gave away too many of the early rounds, but I don't think he did. I think he actually won those early rounds by employing. So, and David Avanesian, I thought this guy was going to get a fight with Keith Thurman. Wasn't that the whole purpose of that?
Yeah, the win against Mosley gave him a version of the WBA belt. It was supposed to set up about against one time.
Yep.
It's a disgrace, I actually like Avanesian. I thought, I had him winning that. I predicted him beating Mosley. I see him fight before. I actually like, what he was doing. He fires that really good left hook combination punch as well. Good fighter, I wouldn't say a tier one, but maybe a B minus, sort of A minus, B plus type of fighter. But Lamont, he's been out of the ring now. I don't know what.
I think somebody it's 16 months. 16 months.
Yep.
Yeah, his last fight was October 2015.
Which
was and think about that fight. It was a fairly questionable decision over Felix Diaz.
Yeah.
It by no means was that a clear victory. Here's the other knock against Peterson. He's 33 years old. And you start having these long layoffs in between fights. This is not to your advantage.
He says he's been in the gym strong, and I've seen clips of him training, and that's one guy that when he says he's in shape, I'm actually going to believe him, because you can look at him and tell he's in it. And I saw a clip of him doing some rope work, doing some head movement work with the ropes in the ring, and he looked damn good and sharp. Like, hell, I was like, I don't think Avanesian beat him at all, but as far as he was getting that with a Danny Garcia again, yeah, probably this go around and affect him, but I think he's going to pound David Avanesian.
Well, I agree. If he says he's in shape, he generally does come in shape and fairly well trained, unlike the men in the man in the main event. So, good luck to him. But boy, when you're out of the ring that long, that age, things are not generally in your favor.
Side note before I go to you, Daniel, what happened to his brother Anthony? He lost to Brandon Rios. He got stopped, but you really hadn't seen anything from him since. Maybe a fight or two. I always thought, even though that loss to Rios, he could come back and still be a very good fighter and potential world champion at 135. I don't understand.
Well, think about it, Mike. It's probably the same reason why first you see Vanes Matarozhan and now Frank Galarza publicly announce they're parting with Al Haymon. Maybe. Since he's not one of Al Haymon's favorite fighters, he's not going to get a shot. So that's that aspect for Peterson's brother. When it comes to this fight, I think the only reason that Avanesian hasn't faced Thurman yet is because of this fight.
Unification.
Because of the unification. So now, like I said, I talked about motivation with Granados. There's motivation with Lamont Peterson. Should Thurman lose to Danny Garcia, you get a chance at a rematch of a fight where a lot of people can argue you won.
Yep.
And really doubt that Angel Garcia wants to see Lamont Peterson again. So there's that aspect. And if Thurman wins, yeah, you get a shot at a guy who's united, and you're technically his mandatory. I don't like the layoff that Peterson's going, but then again, like I said, that may be just more of him not being in favor of his promoter, Al Haymon. But that's another issue for another day. I do think Peterson probably will win, because I'm one of those people that does believe him when he says he's trained. He does stay in the gym. He's a little bit of a gym rat. So when he comes in shape, he does come in shape. And Avanesian really doesn't strike me as like a really, really good like really solid power puncher, because those are the guys that can hurt Peterson. Like, exactly. Like we saw what happened with him and Lucas Matisse. So I don't think Emerson has that. He does have good things. He does do really good movement. You have to move in order to beat Shane Mosley. But at this point, I think there's probably a little bit more of motivation for Peterson. He knows if he wins, he either gets a fight, a revenge fight against Danny Garcia, or he gets a fight where with Keith Thurman, I really test to see who's among the best in that division.
Thurman's got a chin, mate. Trust me.
A Thurman fight is fun, the way that Peterson goes to the body, you know, like he goes to the body very hard. Thurman having those problems running from Collazo with the body shot. Porter snuck in one. That's a fun fight. I don't think Danny Garcia's beating Keith Thurman at all. So I do think Avanesian, he's going to get broken down. This guy's strong, man. Lamont Peterson's a strong fighter.
He shifts inside the pocket. When he's there, he takes like two steps to the side and he fires that left hand over. So when Peterson will be trying to jab, I think he'll just outmaneuver him in the pocket.
But the thing is, Peterson does a good job of keeping his hands up high. Yeah. So maybe that left over the top will not be as effective.
Even when Matisse knocked him out, you could just see the confidence of his own game to say, okay, this guy wants to come after me. I want to fight fire with fire on the inside because that's what I do. And he made a perfect move. It just so happened that Matisse got right in between him keeping that hand up, and it just ended it. So yeah. I do think he's one of the more technically brilliant fighters out here because he don't make many mistakes. It's just the luck of the draw right there. You know, he might not be world class, but I think I think he's a hell of a fighter. He's going to beat Avanesian down. That body work's going to pay dividends.
Yeah, and I think I'm going to end the show on that.
Hey, Mike, one more thing.
Go ahead.
Yeah. He might as well do this now. Yeah.
One more thing. Joe Smith Jr., buddy, I warned you. I've listened to your interviews in and out, and I've heard you say you're not going to Canada. You didn't say it, but every time you were asked about Canada, you said, but I'm a draw in New York, but I'm this in New York. I warned you.
When you fight
Shawnee Monahan, because this Adonis fight is thrown off. That's what they just reported. The fight is out. Welcome to the shit list, buddy.
You're cursed, motherfucker.
You're cursed.
Yeah.
Oh dear.
Well, we'll put it to you this way: Yvonne Michelle just doesn't do business in the U.S. And unfortunately,
to mute Daniel now.
No one wants to hear him. This is the thing, though. No, he doesn't do business in the U.S. And unfortunately, that's what Joe LaGuardia pushed. He pushed it for a New York fight because he in turn doesn't want to go to Canada.
The Shawnee Monahan fight is complete and utter garbage, man. No one wants to see that.
He know it gets him paid, and that's the sad part about it. He's going to Doug Lineage for a damn payday. And some other guy say he won a 50-50 payday with Stevenson, and that shit just
That actually is false. That's not true in the 50-50. But what it is true, unfortunately, is that Joe LaGuardia did want to fight either in Barclays or in Nassau Coliseum, because it's unfortunately part of the thing of the New York insurance law. Unfortunately, Joe LaGuardia doesn't have the means to really put on really, really good cards in New York without those fees. And the Stevenson fight could have done it. It could have drawn enough people where you could have covered that insurance fee. But that's why he wanted to fight in New York. It's kind of stupid that he didn't do the fight in Canada. But then again, I keep remembering my trip to Niagara Falls and how insane Canadian taxes can be. Mm. So in a fight where you're probably not going to get the boatload of money and you're going to get taxed both by New York State and on the border, I get why they did it. It's kind of stupid, though, at the same time, because if you don't do this now, if you do the Monahan fight, yeah, it's gonna be a big fight here in New York, in Long Island. Yes, it'll do numbers in Nassau Coliseum. But unless then your next opponent is either Andre Ward or Sergey Kovalev, then people are gonna clown you. People are going to clown you. People clown Jared Herring after his loss here, and he's from here. So that's the main issue. Like I said, I get why Joe LaGuardia wanted to fight in New York. I get why he did it. He needs the money. He needs to put his fighters in fight. One of those fighters, remember, interestingly enough, is Chris Algieri. So he needs to put, he needs to get the money right to put it in there. At the same time, though, yeah, if you have to bite the bullet and fight in Canada, fight in Canada.
I like to, he was reasonable about it, and we had the conversation before, but I do believe the fight would do more in Canada. I think Joe Smith is out, you know, sort of like he's getting a big head. Like, I've done this. I heard him on TBV saying, yeah, but I'm a draw in New York. And I'm like, you haven't even fought in New York. Like, what you have? And maybe you did some shows, but man, this is for the lineal title. But you can't get knocked out in this fight. So I don't know, man. I'm sad because I've been fiending for some Adonis Stevenson fight, and he wants to fight three times this year. The next fight's in April. And I'm not getting an opponent I want, likely, because you don't even have an opponent yet. So I'm
pissed. PBC recoups in Canada because it licensed the fights to other channels in Canada. And some of them actually charge, they pay an upfront fee just to even get the licensing right. So that's why Heyman always likes these Canadian fighters to fight in Canada, because he actually recoups money from them.
It does. That's why. That's why it makes sense. That's why it makes sense for him to do the fights in Canada. And that, and yeah, Yvonne Michelle just doesn't do business in the US. So there's the whole thing. But I get why Joe LaGuardia did the move he had to do. But when you don't have a strong hand, and unfortunately Joe Smith just having the silver title is not gonna be a strong enough hand where you can say you have to come here. It's not, unfortunately. As much as it would have been fun, he's not gonna come. Yeah, you're gonna have to fight you're gonna have to go across the bridge in Canada. You're gonna have to eat New York State tax, and you're gonna have to eat all the taxes that Canada charges you.
I'm not sure if he's cursed yet. I'm not sure if he's cursed yet, but
he's cursed, man.
I'm not sure yet, cuz. I'm not sure yet, but hey, if you say so, you know, hey.
I've got the dough, and I'm rubbing the dough now. I'm unleashing it.
Oh, Lord.
This show is officially off the rails.
Let's end it on that note. I'm gonna go around the
Joe Smith, you will be knocked out against Monahan.
and on that show, let's go around the panel here. Ladies first, as always, Gail Fuck with Dog Communities Digital News for folks who want to talk to sweet science. The Dog Show, which I missed this year, I missed most of it. And anything else, let the folks know where they can find you.
The oldest sporting event in the United States, the Westminster Kennel Club Dog Show. And let it be known for the record that a boxer almost won. So there you go. Boxer, best in the working class. So when we are not watching dogs at Madison Square Garden, we're watching fights, and we're covering them. I am on Communities Digital News, which is COMM, C-O-M-M, Digi, D-I-G-I News, commdiginews.com. From my lips to God's ear, please let Adrian Broner get what he deserves.
What day is that fight? Is it Friday or Saturday?
That is Saturday.
Gus from Corruption in Boxing, again, as I stated earlier in the show, my condolences to you and your family and the passing of your uncle. For folks who want to talk to Sweet Science or talk music, let the folks know where they can hit you up.
Yeah, thank you, Michael. Corruption in Boxing, all platforms, YouTube, Gmail, Skype. Still working on the website, but it's very, very slow forthcoming. music wise, I'm writing for Juno Beatport, hopefully a magazine very, very soon. Covert Operative is my name, and you can see my articles on there.
Scorsese, for folks who want to talk the Sweet Science or anything else, or let the folks know where they can find you and big up your YouTube page.
Fair warning, follow me next week, because this week I'm probably just going to be cursing the name of Joe Smith all week long. But if you want, you can curse along with me at My Low Place on Twitter. And my YouTube page is Low Place, hashtag MLPF. And we could talk boxing either platform.
You know I'll be cursing with you.
Daniel Caldwell, the Inscribers. For folks who want to talk boxing or talk the NBA, specifically the Miami Heat, who scored a big win last night. Let the folks know where they can find you.
Yep. Ending the season right. Ending the first half of the season right. Vatic win over James Harden and the Houston Rockets. But you can find me on Twitter, Ruckus99. I am going to do a Heat preview for the All-Star break coming into the second half of the season. And like I said, most likely looking to see what the rumblings are this year, because I get it, Joe LaGuardia, but you had the wrong hand here, man. Go to Canada.
Indeed, indeed. Before I give my info and stuff, I want to give a shout out to the homie EJ Boxing Live. Today he's celebrating his birthday, so I want to give a shout out to him over in the UK. For folks who want to, and also once again, as I said earlier in the show, shout out to Jacob from Jab Hook. Couldn't be on the show tonight, but he's listening to his live, listening to the live show on YouTube. For folks who want to talk boxing or music or anything else with me, you know what it is. Brother JR on Twitter at Brother JR76. As I stated to begin the show, if you want to find out all things about Pound for Pound Box Report, please check out the blog page, p4pboxreport.wordpress.com. It's the link. You look to the right of the blog page. I provide links of where to find the pages of Pound for Pound Box Report on Facebook, on Tumblr, on G+, as well as the YouTube channel. Also provide links to where you can find us on iTunes, Stitcher Radio, Player FM, SoundCloud, Google Play Music as well. Next episode, we will do a recap of Broner Granados. We will do a recap of Avanesian, Lamont Peterson. And we will also go into more detail about Tony Harrison, Gerald Hurd. We will talk about Wilder making his return to the ring, Deontay Wilder fighting Gerald Washington. Cecilia Brakus is fighting the night before. Really good light heavyweight bout between Eliander Alvarez and Lucien Boutte taking place in Quebec City. So we will talk about all of those bouts plus any other boxing news in the interim. So for Gail Falcon, Dollar Communities Digital News, for Scorsese, for Gus from Corruption and Boxing, from Daniel from the Inscriber, this has been episode 158. Of the Pound for Pound Boxing Report. I'm your host, Michael. We will see you next week. Everybody have a good evening. Good night.
Good night.
See you later.
Good night.